Disastrous malfunctions at such facilities as the Fukushima nuclear power plant in Japan in 2011 and Chernobyl in Russia in 1986 serve as examples of what may happen if radioactive nuclear waste is released into the environment, and biologists have even found leaves and dead plant material piling up near Chernobyl's blast site, as natural decomposers like bacteria, fungi, and small insects cannot survive the harmful energy emission from the radiation. With this in mind, today's measures of exposing of nuclear waste, including high-level waste from nuclear blasts or nuclear power cores, are carefully done, though there are more than one way of doing so. Some types of nuclear reactants or products take dozens of thousands of years to reach levels which do not affect the environment, and irradiated material could contaminate groundwater, so many countries are meticulously making plans for storage within underground repositories. When nuclear fuel ore, typically uranium, is mined, it is refined into uranium-235, the form of uranium necessary for the greatest release of energy, at either 5% for use in nuclear power generation or 90% for use in nuclear weapons. Click here to find out how this energy release occurs. Once the fuel is spent, it typically spends several years submerged in water, where it releases heat and radiation, cools, then is ready for storage or reprocessing. The storage process ranges from storage above land in casks to placement within crystalline rock or deep boreholes, and the cask process involves placement of the cooled nuclear material in 38-centimeter thick iron or steel structures, where some heat-generating spontaneous fission from the ongoing reactions within the material is drawn away and released by the metal walls. Helium also fills the empty space within these casks to allow maintenance workers to check for leaks. Although storage of high-level nuclear waste in casks may be suitable for 100 years or more before requiring maintenance, some prefer to bury waste for longer periods in ground storage. This can be done through placing the nuclear waste within non-corrosive copper structures, surrounding them with clay, which protects the seal of the copper structures, then placing the vessel 500 meters below ground surface in hard crystalline bedrock, though there is still some potential contamination with groundwater. Other nuclear repositories, however, like one which was planned for the Yucca Mountain wastelands of Nevada, store nuclear waste above the water table in underground packages. There are even deep borehole methods involving burying contaminated material 3 to 5 kilometers underground surface where water is isolated, and glass encasing methods involving mixing the contaminated material into molten glass, which entraps radiation and hardly breaks down over time. Such methods cannot always be implemented, as in earthquake-prone Japan, where casks may be used but underground storage cannot be, but the more expensive measures of reprocessing and recycling are becoming popular globally. In South Korea, for example, a 500 degrees Celsius voloxidizer oxidizes unstable uranium dioxide pellets into stable U3O8 powder, and in Russia, the revolving plasma within fusion reactors may be used as a centrifuge to separate components of radioactive waste from one another for effective reprocessing, among other separation techniques. The prospect of nuclear reactions as a way of diversifying a nation's renewable energy has encouraged hundreds to sprout up around the world, despite the possibility of stored nuclear waste being accessed by violent groups. Even so, alternatives like thermal solar power focus light energy from the sun's own nuclear reactions to generate steam and power turbines, similar to how a nuclear reactor spins turbines with steam, and are arguably more sustainable, as there is a limited supply of not only nuclear materials but also materials which are used during the processes, like hafnium, a metal used to bring great integrity to superalloys.